This is the SF Productions Podcast Network.
Good evening and welcome to another exciting episode of Vast Wasteland.
Secret Square. Could it be Bob Denver, Karen Valentine, Walt, the cast of Soap, Henry Winkler, Mr. Ed and Wilbur, Marty J. Wiley, Mark Schmidbauer, and in the center square, Wilbert Neal. All on the new
is Tuesday at 6, Wednesday the 10, Thursdays at 3. At Darren Pamela Ferdin. No, not another Burgess Meredith show.
Welcome to the place your parents didn't understand.
The world of 60s and 70s television.
Welcome to Vast Wasteland.
Welcome home.
Hello and welcome to Vast Wasteland, the video journal of popular culture. I'm Mark Spinbar, along with Wilbert Neal and Marty Willow. Well, tonight we're just going to do a grab bag, just whatever comes into our head as we go through the next half an hour of using update. So there you go.
Freeform.
As it were.
Freeform television.
Exactly. But before we get into that, we want to tell you that we're on Wednesdays at 10, Thursdays at 3, and Saturdays, if they feel like it, at City Hall. There you go.
Middle of the night, if they feel like
right.
It, at City Hall.
And if you want to write into us, it's Box 15, 1411, Columbus, Ohio, 43215. And I really wish people would start using that darn P.O. Box. It costs money for that P.O. Box. Come on.
Email.
Or you can email us. The new method at bassw@cubserve.com. And then you can check out the webpage, which is really, really, really long.
It's really, really long. Really, really old.
Yeah.
Webpage.
Yeah.
Webpage.
Now, and
also, then, if you can't get a hold of the
yeah,
any of those
you can, like this guy did, just call the station and say hi. Magnus, I hope I pronounced this right, Magnus Smedel, which is a cool name. Just a note here, just moved here and loves our show. Was interested in sitting on a taping if possible.
He'd like to be the studio audience.
Yes. we used to do that a long time ago. So I don't know. Maybe we'll get in touch with you and see if you want to come in and be our audience of one.
Either that or we'll just drag you and make you become a volunteer.
Yeah.
Send you through classes. You can be
there you go.
The crew.
Exactly. And actually, speaking of web pages, like we were a second ago, there's a web page I'd like to point you toward if you're interested in this kind of thing. If you're interested in television criticism, kind of really best way. Sarcastic television criticism
okay.
would be the best way to describe it. check out www.tv, that's TEEVEE.org.
Org.
And,
but you know, we're all getting, so it used to be everybody would give the web addresses.
Yeah.
HTTP://. I actually saw a commercial, I can't remember what it was for the other day, that's what an impression it made on me, that just said basically productname.com.
Yeah.
No www, no, it's HTTP.
Well, most of the browsers now, you don't have to type in www anymore.
Right, you just go, it's like, it's gotten so condensed.
Yeah, exactly.
We were just taking it for granted now, you know.
Yeah.
But when people fill out forms, even though it's a local form they're filling out, because I'm at the library, mm-hmm. so people still put their area code down. There's no space for the area code. They will squeeze in the area code. So telephone numbers have gotten longer.
Right.
Web addresses have gotten
shorter. And it'd be interesting, you know, that somebody who you could, like, or take a magazine from today and give it to somebody from 5 years ago. What are these things? Every advertiser, www, what is that?
www,
what is that?
People are really into wrestling?
Yeah. I don't know. Well, it's kind of like the change that happened when MTV came out and changed commercials. Because you see commercials prior to about 1982.
You watch the TV Land commercials.
Yeah, they're leisurely. It's like, all right, now we're going to start talking about this.
It's wonderful. It's green. It's purple. It's blue. Yeah, the button.
I'll drink a pot of coffee.
Yeah.
We'll sit here and have our evening meal.
It's like a fireside chat.
Here's some nice features of this product. And my
children will grow from infancy to adulthood during the time of this commercial.
The really old ones, like there's some video collections of really old commercials.
Mm-hmm.
They tell you the price.
Right.
Just 99 cents. So run it out, Mama Denver. 99 cents.
It's only $19.95. Take a shot. Da-da. It says yes.
Yeah, I mean,
got it. Done.
They gave you the actual price.
Hey, beat the swinger. Pull her a swinger. Beat the swinger.
So
a little bit of nostalgia.
And now MTV's got the commercials, so it's like,
yeah. And now the commercial is where you don't know what the product is,
and you don't know what the web address is because the commercial went too fast to even bother putting any attention into it.
Yeah, and
that's one of the cool things about some of them. You don't know what the product is until they say at the end.
Yeah,
you're looking at
what is it? What are you selling? What is it?
Do I want that? I don't think so.
I don't know what it is. Is it a fragrance? Is it a breath mint? Is it, you know?
It's a tennis shoe with a fragrant breath mint.
Beef jerky?
Tongue.
What are you selling? Yeah.
And it turns out to be
Coke. And now, of course, the new thing now is the Saga commercials, not just the Taste Your Choice Saga,
which finished up in England years ago.
Yeah, and we still haven't seen
it. But we're still dragging it out.
Right.
We're never going to see the end of those because they've lost interest basically.
Right. But now they have these sagas where it's like, again, they're not selling anything in the commercial, and they're all like, there's this Levi's set.
I can remember that's for blue jeans.
Right. Yeah.
So
those have nothing at all to do with blue jeans.
Yeah.
There's everything else but blue jeans, except that everybody in them was wearing blue jeans.
And there's one that one of the soft drinks just started where it's this father and daughter talking about something, and it's just like, and there are places in the zoo. And it's this whole set of commercials, and other than the fact that the guy happens to be drinking that particular beverage during the event,
soft sell.
Really soft.
The homie time.
You have no clue what it is.
When are they going to realize we don't pay any attention to commercials unless they have a cute character that we can all buy, you know, merchandise with?
Right.
Or cute. They don't have cute songs anymore.
Right.
They don't have, you know, any plop plop. This is oh, what a relief it is. You don't hear those little jingle songs anymore. Barry Manilow, get busy and write some more jingles for us.
We need a new jingleer.
I mean, they're scarfing up all these songs, which kind of makes me. I don't like that.
Mm.
I mean, you know, I just like hear a song and I think, oh, the video.
No, it's a commercial.
Oh, they sold that
Burger
one already.
King.
Just came out last week. Or it's Burger King or something. And it's like, no, that's just not forget. Get original.
There's a very funny commercial out right now for one of the soft drinks, where the kids are sitting around.
Woo kids! The little sunshine comes off.
Let's have this orange drink or whatever, and this little cartoon character pops off the box. Hi, kids! And they're like, ah!
And I'm running.
And they're running down the hall and terrified of it. You know, it's like, Mommy, what is it?
I've seen that one. And then there was the other one they got me with the other day was the one that looks like they've made a cola out of tofu.
Yeah.
I saw that one. I'm like, a tofu cola? Because I eat the stuff. So, you know, I'm willing to try anything they make out of this bean curd, okay? It's like the ice cream is great, so cola might be good. And then it's like, oh, it's not for that. And then the guy makes his face. It's like, oh, it's a fake commercial.
So, well, and
I don't want no more fake commercials.
Well, and talking about commercials is a natural segue into the Olympics. Because there's been just way too many commercials. As we tape this, the Olympics is going into its, fifth week. I don't know. It's been going on forever.
It's the Winter Olympics.
Yeah, really. It could well be. This could show in, 2003 for all we know.
The Olympics that put Nagano, Japan on the map.
Yeah.
Before the Olympics, you're like, where? The Olympics are going to be where? And now Nagano is a household name, a household word. By golly, everybody, you say Nagano. Oh, Olympics!
Oh, Nagano. Okay.
The commercials. I haven't watched the whole because I'm not big on the sports thing or anything, but I do watch. We do watch the opening ceremonies because this is different. This is usually cool, and then you get to see. And it was like winter fashion review.
Yeah.
Because all the countries were like, oh man, they can't do it. Go home. You can't dress. Oh, the coats are nice. The hat. Go home. So that's what. But then. They have this really fantastic thing that they're doing with all this technology where the conductor was conducting the five courses on five continents, and it was all hooked up with the satellites, and they had gotten rid of the delay so that it was all happening right then.
And they spent 2 hours promoting the fact that it was going to happen.
And then they put 10 minutes of commercials in the middle of it.
And not only did they put commercials in the middle of it, they included a taped interview in the middle of the thing with one of the skaters. And I'm like, what is this about?
And it's
you could have shown this later, earlier, or something, and not during the big events.
And it's not like I'm big on classical music or anything, but this was a piece of classical music I could actually recognize because it was a Clockwork Orange. So, so when it comes back from all the commercials, I dozed off during the commercials. I wake up and I hear this very familiar little refrain. Clockwork Orange is on? Oh, they're still doing this, and they're going to let us see some more. Just tacky.
Yes, I actually was checking out some of the official websites while this whole thing's been going on. And so CBS had their site, and they had a feedback area. And there were hundreds of messages from people all going, this is the tackiest thing you've ever done. You've done a horrible disservice. And in fact, some people were writing in saying that we never learned this, of course, because they never mentioned it during the coverage. The ballet thing that was going on in the middle. Those were American ballet dancers. And one guy wrote, my sister was in there and I didn't get to see her.
So basically you only got to see that if you had a satellite hookup right into your home.
Well, you'd have to have picked up, like they were saying, the guy from New Hampshire said, well, I can pick up CBC out of Canada.
So I had
far superior covers than
you had
CBS
to pick up
did.
Like a cultured country.
Exactly. Instead of our tacky country that was like, oh, classical music, time for commercial.
Now I saw the little the cute little kids come out.
Yeah.
The little Nukinkos?
Well, I don't remember what they're called.
Snow children.
The snow children. I'm trying to learn a little Japanese names. Absolutely adorable. So I thought they're a new Winter Olympic sport. You hunt them down to get their hats, because I want one of those little hats. You just set them all loose in the woods,
in the biathlon.
And you get to go after them, okay? get to catch the snow kid. When you catch them, you get to take their cute little hat.
Where is your own?
Kind of an Olympic, maybe you do with a paintball gun,
Yeah,
boom,
there you go. There you got them.
And then you run up and you snatch the little hat off their head. Because, one of those little hats. And you probably can't get that little hat unless you're a snow child.
One thing they do with every Olympics is they always have mascot or mascots. And now they've got these mascots, and I don't think I've ever really heard what the mascot's name is or anything. All I know is it's a little like an anime character with big puffy cheeks. That's all I've seen.
I thought they were kind of owls or something.
They're kind of owl, rather
they've
owl-like
They've got some kind of owl-like
shape.
Name or something. These are owls, but they're not owls.
Yeah.
Owl littling thing. Anger.
Don't you know he's not a big hamster? No.
And now my question is, who told Jim Nantz he was a great commentator?
Who is he?
Jim Nantz is like the main host for CBS.
Okay, you've been watching the show, so
this guy doesn't have a clue. This guy is the most wooden announcer I've ever seen in my life. This guy should be like in the Poughkeepsie market doing the sports, you know? This guy should not have anything to do with national television. He's horrible. And so this bodes pretty ill for people who are into NFL football now that CBS has bought the rights back for the AFC games. This is the guy you're going to be looking at next fall.
I don't watch football.
This guy who just doesn't have a clue. And actually, I think it was on last night when the U.S. won the gold, that
beat Canada.
Yep.
I heard Canada was talking trash and they got beat.
Yep. Well, they had Brian Gumbel on who did a very good interview with the team right after the game, and then they cut directly to this Jim Nantz guy interviewing a couple of them, and it was just like night and day in terms of the quality of the interview. It was just like, well, you know, you can tell he's very clearly looking at cue cards to see what these girls' names are. And
looking at cue cards to find the teleprompter.
Well,
fill in the name here.
Fill in the name here. But to really see truly bizarre coverage, you got to go over to TNT for the daytime, the afternoon coverage they've been doing. Because somebody at Turner got this great idea that in order to simulate a Japanese home as much as possible, apparently Japanese homes don't have they don't have central heating. A traditional Japanese home doesn't have central heating, and in a lot of cases they're open to the outside air on certain sides of the house, and you just have space heaters everywhere. Well, that's how they built this set for this. The main set.
Oh, terribly energy efficient.
Yeah. The main set for this, and Jim Lampley's on there. He used to be on ABC, and his breath is frosting, you know, as he's announcing stuff. I mean, it's probably like 20 degrees in the studio. Who thought of this?
No.
And he gets a laryngitis after like the first day.
Open captioning for all.
Yeah. And then, you know, it's like, for some reason they decided TNT wanted to do their pieces on Japanese culture. So they brought in this Japanese chef to do little kitchen segments. And he speaks like very halting English, so you really can't understand him very well. And it's clear he's very uncomfortable with doing this whole thing in front of a camera. And it's like,
gotten any fingers yet?
Yeah, well, but it's like, wow, who is the guy who was planning this thing out? Who is the, you know, who is producing this? Well, what a fiasco.
What can we do? Japanese chef.
Yeah, that's it.
People like the Japanese chefs. They go to those restaurants all the time. They like to see them. They chop the stuff. They flip the things around. We can have them doing that right behind us.
This is the triumphant return of the generic TV producer. We haven't seen that character for a while.
Yeah.
The Weasley TV producer.
The chef, yeah.
Yeah.
I'll be the chef. Well,
I think they should just show more Toonami.
More speed racer. And then, you know, because they're gearing this whole thing really not toward a sports audience, because they're trying to bring in people who normally wouldn't watch sports.
Well, these are sports that nobody normally watches anyway.
So, I mean,
it's pretty sports a lot of times with the skating and... Yeah. I mean, you know, I was at a party on Saturday night, and people actually got up and left this wonderful vampire movie marathon to go watch figure skating. Go fig.
Yeah.
Well, they want to see somebody's knees get whacked. That's
well, it's just the vampire marathon.
but the thing is, not only, you know, so they're doing all this figure skating, and so they're not only doing the performances, but they've now sunk to the level of, well, we really don't have anything to show right now, so we're taking you live to the practice rink, where we're going to watch somebody practice live.
And mess up.
Practicing live on national television?
We just don't have the soap opera drama with the
whole Tanya and Nancy thing.
Yeah, I mean, That was
a whole new degree of difficulty for skating.
Right.
Yeah.
And they just don't have it
How
now.
Big a soap opera is your life?
Yeah. Oh, man.
It's the society
the
queen
iron
bar
new
wife. Crash.
Okay, she's going into the camel. Oh, no, there's a camel! Oh, oh, how can she recover after that?
After that one.
Oh, the judges are being hard. Oh, no. Oh, goodness.
I broke my skate. I broke my leg. Hey,
the judges aren't being kind at all.
It's just not there.
No.
Oh, it's the flamethrower on the ice. Oh!
How about skeet shooting combined with figure skating? When they go up and do those twirls, you can take
Wow.
It's not with ammo.
Paint gun. I like the idea of biathlon and figure skating.
Oh, the
together.
One thing that cracked me up was the snowboarder
yeah.
that lost his medal, the Canadian snowboarder. Yeah. They took his medal away, and then they said, hey, wait a minute. Marijuana doesn't enhance performance. We have to give it back.
He's like, that's right, man.
Yeah,
I got one.
Being that I work in a public place, I can talk to people. I can kind of do informal public polls on
yeah.
this. And most of the people have come through and we've commented about it and said, hey, you should have two medals for doing it that way. Anybody who's willing to get on a wooden board in that condition and go down a mountain full of snow,
right.
it's two medals.
Right.
And by the way, kids, snow safety is important.
Right.
No, we don't get snow here anymore.
Well, for just recent events, some recent tragedies have happened in the news. Snow safety is important.
Well, skiing is dangerous.
Safety is important.
Skiing is very dangerous.
Do not mix skiing
and football. Yes.
Do not mix skiing and celebrity.
Right.
If you're famous, don't ski.
Pay attention yeah. to the course.
Yeah.
And if you're in an airplane, up high.
Wear a helmet.
Yeah.
Of course, the one thing I did see on a website called Joke a Day that actually sends me a clever joke every day that I can never remember them.
Yeah.
After I laugh, it's gone. But the one I did remember, it said, message from the tree, stop making paper or we'll kill a celebrity a week. Which at the time made a lot of sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now everybody's going, huh? What do they mean? Yeah. Message from the trees.
Oh, man. Well, of course, the whole Olympics has been besought with either there was lack of snow right before the Olympics, and they're like, oh no, we're gonna have to truck in snow and all this, and
and then there was
and then
too much
way
snow.
Too much snow. And it's
and it wasn't your good pack, it was that unruly snow. That unruly snow, by
that
golly,
nasty snow.
They got out there afterwards and they couldn't even ski straight. It's like you get a couple skiers down there, they make ruts in the thing.
Yeah.
And so it's like, okay, well, we've got the ruts now, so you can either follow the ruts or you can make your own path. Well, I'll make my own path. Oh! They're going off the side into the plastic fences there.
A good inner tube down the slope would help. Maybe that's it. This next thing. Now let snowboarding in. Now let inner tubing in.
Oh, yeah.
Inner tubing down a hill. If you can do that and wind up on the inner tube at the bottom of the hill, you've done a darn good job.
Exactly.
Plus, you'd also smooth out that snow for any skiers. Be like, send down the inner tube, send down the skier, send down the tuber,
send down the tube.
And you don't get any ropes on that inner tube either.
Yeah.
It's just bare tube all the way.
You can't send a Zamboni down in.
Yeah. If you can't dig your claws into the rubber inner tube, then you're a wuss.
Well, and speaking of going down hills, they showed this segment during the opening ceremonies. There were the log raising people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And well, apparently this pales to what these guys normally do, because they're all loggers in Japan.
Okay.
And if they get to the point where, oh, we got to go down this cliff face or whatever to get this to the river, what they'll do is all just jump on the log and ride it down. It was like
that could be a heck of an Olympic event.
Yeah. And they're showing it. It's like, I mean, this enormous trunk of a tree that's like, I don't know, 100 feet long, 10 feet in diameter, and they all just basically lash themselves to the tree, and for fun, they go down this cliff with it. I'm like, what?
I can dig on that.
Man, what is that about?
It's General Bat Guano riding a bomb. Woo-hoo!
Woo! Think about it. We used to go down big hills on little pieces of wood called sleds.
But I'm not even talking about snow hills. I'm just talking about like mud hills.
Yeah. Those saucers, you can use them all year long, Mark. it's not a seasonal item.
I'm not even talking about going down hills. I mean, it's like cliff faces. Just like, okay.
What? I'm up for that.
Yeah. Very.
That's one of those sports where you don't have to do a lot of training. Just right. Hang yeah. on for
if
dear
you
life.
Hang on, you're fine. If you don't hang
you know,
on,
you
your toes.
The, all the adrenaline and everything kicks in. You know, no training needed. You just show up and do it.
And you get the young ones to get down the ball. Let's do it again.
Yeah, well, you just drag the log back up the hill and you can
right.
do it as many times
you
as you want.
You gotta supply your own log.
I like the sumo dudes ceremony.
Yep.
Stomping out, you know, clapping up the spirits. And watch out, baby. They'll recruit you.
Yeah.
But he was like, he's like the only American sumo, because I know they pulled him out of Hawaii when he was a young man and just kept training him and feeding him. And I guess those guys drink a lot of beer and stuff and eat everything in sight.
Well, when you do
get
help,
huge.
Yeah.
That's why the snow children left so quickly.
The sumo guys are coming.
No, because later the sumo guys were carrying little snow kids, and they were... You were sleeping through this part, and they were bringing in the fashion parade.
Oh, that was like...
And it was really bizarre. It was really bizarre. Like, Australia and the United States had, like, almost the same coats. Mm. I mean, you know, it was those long rider coats, you know, those Australian coats.
Yep.
And I was kind of sitting there waiting. I'm thinking, let's see, is the United States going to wear cowboy hats or baseball hats? Cowboy hats or baseball? It had to be one of the two.
Yeah.
It was the cowboy hat, which I thought the baseball hat would look nicer, but, you know, they went for the whole Western theme.
Right. Well, they probably have those left over from Calgary, so. Yeah. The Olympics, you got to turn your stuff back in. There you go.
Did have good-looking coats.
But the amount of commercials that we've seen during this during the games is just horrible. And that you not only do you have just the commercials going on, but you have the outdoor announcers who are wearing parkas with a very prominent swoosh.
Well, now you know it'll be really bad when a ski jumper, say, does his run, gets to the bottom, does the, you know, they slide out there and everything, and then someone runs up to him with the mic and goes, that was a great run, and what kind of skis did you use?
Yeah.
And they do the pitch right there. That's when it'll be really, really, really bad.
Well, to that point, we got the U.S. men's hockey team, which is just like this NHL all-star team, which, I mean... I rarely, if ever, will I root against the United States in an Olympic event. I was actively rooting against the United States. I'm like, no, these are big.
We don't know this man.
Big professional babies who are like, ooh, we don't have to qualify for this thing. We just want to go into the medal round automatically, and they got their butts kicked. It's like big professional babies. Rich guys were like, I want another medal for my, you know. They weren't doing it for the United States. They were doing it for themselves. They were doing it to get this medal to put on their mantle.
I guess we have to start following hockey now.
Say, look how important I am. There you go.
Uh-oh.
Well, looks like we're just about out of time. Next time on the show, one thing we're going to be doing, people enjoyed that darn do-your-own autograph photo of the Vast Wasteland cast. Get your camera ready for the next show, because we're going to do another one of those. It was so popular, we're going to do it again, but we're giving you some notice this time. So
get the film on your camera,
ready right now.
Right by your TV so that you can be ready.
So for all of us here at Last Wasteland, we'll see you next time. Good night, everybody.
Good evening.